All right, we're a few minutes past our starting hour, but I'll call this meeting, the regular June meeting of the Historic Preservation Commission to order. Note that we have a quorum. For all the guests, there are copies of the agenda in the back of the room if you have not seen that. And I would direct your attention to the statement at the bottom of the agenda, which sets forth the authority and the purposes for this Historic Preservation Commission. The first item on our agenda is the consent agenda, which includes the minutes of the May 16 meeting, administrative COAs for the period of May 12 to June 14, a list of new historic district property owners. Is there a motion to accept the consent agenda?
I so move.
Second?
Second.
In favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. The next item on our agenda is the election of officers for July 2016 to June of 2017. In accordance with the bylaws of the HPC, the commission is charged with selecting from among our number a chairman and a vice chairman. I'm not eligible.
I'd like to nominate Commissioner Butterfield for chair and Commissioner Morris for vice chair.
All right. We have nominations. Campaigning is over, and
Chris McSwain would make a good vice chair.
Okay.
If he's willing to accept it.
I'm willing.
Okay. So we have a full slate. Chairman, Commissioner Butterfield, and Vice Chair, Commissioner McSwain. Declare nominations closed and call for a vote. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. All right, congratulations to our officers. And according to the bylaws, terms begin July 1. Okay. First item on our action agenda is a request of Jay Oshren to paint the exterior of 1420 Church Street. Mr. Oshren.
Commissioners.
Please state your name and address for the record.
Jay Oshren, 1391 Ridgeway Farm, Charlottesville, Virginia, 22911.
All right. And you have submitted a COA to paint this house at
That's 1420
Church Street.
Yeah.
And yes, the colors that you selected or proposed
are the I think you should. I've given gave Robin a chip.
The,
yeah, okay,
are
right.
Those colors?
Yes, right, dried thyme and rosemary. So the darker as the base and the lighter green as the clabbered, and white, pure white as trim.
All right. Our guidelines do set forth some guidelines for paint colors, and I'll ask our applications committee if they have reviewed this, and do you have comment or recommendation?
Well, first I need to clarify something. I think you said something a little contradictory. You said the clapboards, and then you said the base. The base is the clapboards.
No, well, the base is the basement. Basement.
Oh, basement.
Yeah, which is stone. There's all, you can see the stone
yeah,
where it's white now.
So
that's about all there is. There's a little on the other side too. You can barely see it.
So the basement is going to be the darker
a
color?
A little darker, correct.
And the clapboards, and then the trim is white?
Correct.
Okay. The current guidelines state that the trim color should be of a darker color. However, this board is right now reviewing colors, and they may change in the near future. Therefore, I recommend that we open this up for discussion.
All right. I'll ask for a comment or questions from commissioners.
Well, I had a couple of concerns because the roof is green. Do you really want to paint the house green?
The roof's probably going to get replaced and or painted in the next 3 or 4 years.
Okay.
It's peeling, and
what
the metal's in good shape. I'll probably paint it. At which point I'll come
so
up.
So it's not going to be a greenhouse with a green roof?
I doubt it. I don't really care for green roofs myself.
What about the shutters?
Shutters are going to stay, I think they're black, and I want to keep them black.
Okay.
Yeah.
I noticed
But I'm not going to be painting them. They're fine.
Okay. So it's going to be the muted green clapboard, white trim, black shutters, and the roof is probably not going to be that.
Yeah, and as of yet undetermined color for the roof. Don't know yet.
Did you turn in a color for the white? I mean, just because so many times there's creams, there's off-white.
White.
just not trying to be picky, just
no, I understand. Pure white, not bone, not cream, not
okay.
Just white. If you were going to go paint the trim in your house, you would get just a white base, you know, pure white. I know there's like 1,000 whites.
Did the review committee decide what category they were putting this under? Is it folk Victorian or?
I think it's.
These houses are, that house,
federal?
I believe, is 19, I want to say 10 or 15 maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe 20, somewhere in that range.
So it's going in from the Victorian into sort of the arts and crafts stage. I still think it sort of has a Victorian
It has a Victorian floor plan.
Yeah. I guess with what you just said, if it's a pure white, depending on that actual, do we have a color sample of the green?
A chip?
Yeah.
Yeah. The rendering of the image is pretty good.
See, these are kind of, these colors to me look like they're sort of a muddy color. And I think in that case, if a white trim is used, it probably should be more of a, it shouldn't be stark white. It should be more of a creamier color. What say you, Ms. Butterfield? What do you think?
Your comment?
I think cream would be better myself, personally. It's not something we're working on with the guidelines.
And the guidelines, if we're talking about folk Victorian, and I guess the reason I was lumping it into folk Victorian is that it's what I call farmhouse Victorian or vernacular. They say the body is tan, red, green, or brown, so is green's fine. But I do think that based on, we've just done a lot of research recently, we understand they're not part of the guidelines. But it did seem like with all of the examples that we were seeing, a cream would be, the pure white was probably out of keeping with the era. And so the cream would be more of what we saw doing the research to update these. However, we say in here, or the guidelines say originally, darker for the trim, so the white's a departure from that. But I think the pure white is awfully stark and love. The green should be wonderful on it.
I mean, he could almost do the darker green for the trim, or lighten up the clapboard color a bit. Because right now, isn't that what it is? It doesn't have a darker green trim on it.
No, there isn't much trim. I mean, it's a pretty basic house. It has a minimal rake. There's no gingerbread. I mean, it's a pretty. It's working. It's a worker house, basically.
Yeah.
It's not the president's house. It's the worker bee house.
So you'd be seeing the sill, which is pretty, you know, definite, and then
mm-hmm.
the window trim itself. Are you redoing the windows as well? Would they be, where you were figuring white on those, or just not part of your application?
They're not part of it.
Okay.
Actually, there's storm windows on there now.
But is there a 2/2 behind, so it's
two
a white?
Two.
So I guess if the white windows are staying, it's going to all read as one element if he does use the stark white. So that would be a vote in the favor of.
The house next door to the left of this one was recently repainted, and it's kind of a mint green color. It has some brown trim, but it also has white, pure white trim as a sort of the more dominant columns and larger piece. So the fascia would be white, and then he's got the crown would be like brown. So he's used white. And our intention, I've worked with my next-door neighbor, I own the other two houses above it, so there's four houses in a group there. And I own three of them, and he owns the one. Our intention was to have all the houses be different colors and have all the houses have white trim, so it ties together as a whole group. That was our intention. So he had the white approved. I assume he had it approved.
What would the commissioners give Mr. Oshwin for guidance?
I don't personally have an objection to the white, but I do think it should be a creamier white. I think you got to stay within those same color groups. I think it's just going to be a stark difference between that muddy green color and the stark white.
And our intention is to do that. Our intention is to have some contrast.
It would have a contrast, but I mean, I'm just saying more creamier white.
And my next door neighbor already has a pure white. I wish I had a photograph of that.
Well,
too. I mean, it's sort of going to throw the whole thing off, but.
Are we ready to make a motion for Mr. Oshwin based on his request for these muted colors and a white trim?
Does staff know whether the paint colors for the house next door
have
been approved?
Of what?
Of the house
14,
next door.
1418 Church.
Did he paint it recently?
Yeah, I think within a year and a half, maybe.
Yeah, Mr. Oshwin, we seem to be sort of stumbling with this trim color, of course, between a white and an off-white or a white and a cream. Are you persistent in the white?
I am. I hate to sound like Donald Trump. I really do. But it's going to look great.
Yeah. Hang on just a second.
I mean,
Tom's looking up that other one.
Yeah, it might have been a couple years. All right.
Tom, if you did the Google Street View, you get a pretty good view of it.
I think he's trying to see if the application
went through, because something that happens sometimes is people use an example, but then they didn't go through the application process, so then we get a little bit stuck.
You did a lot of work. I can't imagine.
Is it the Four Square House?
Mark Seamster, but I don't. He might have a, it might be a company name, I don't know.
It was supposed to be cream.
Okay, well, I mean, I could find a really, really, really white cream, I suppose.
Do we actually have the color?
Do we have the color
that
chip?
Something
called Andover cream.
I could talk to Mark and get it.
Is it a Sherwin-Williams color?
I would have to go get the hard copy file to know what. Let's see.
They can match that. That's one of them. I just need to get a good chip of it. And that would be fine. I mean, that would be fine.
All right, then. Should I make a motion?
Please.
I move to approve the applicant with the colors selected, with the exception of the trim to match Andover cream.
It's not a hill I want to die on. It's fine.
Just a minute. All right. Is that your motion?
Yes.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Now let me ask the applicant, is that acceptable?
That would be great. Thanks. Is it Sherwin-Williams?
I can't tell.
I can talk to Mark. He'll tell me.
Is that acceptable?
So then with the Andover white, everything else is okay.
All right.
That'd be great.
Fine.
Yeah.
Any other comment or question? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Those in favor of the motion, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, sir.
Great. Thank you. Can I get the chips back?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Now, you also have the next COA to paint the exterior at 1414 Church. And the colors here.
Don't have a chip.
We didn't.
So Andover White's fine as the trim. I was going to do pure white, but that's fine. It's more of a, that's the color. Right now, the house is a tan. It's actually very similar to that color. It's a little richer, the color I'm proposing. Because the house next door is blue. So the furthest away house, it goes blue, and then this color, and then the mint green, and then the green you just approved. So I want there to be sort of contrast between the houses, yeah. So, you know, different.
Okay. The applications committee review this, and do you have a recommendation?
Thank you. That's it.
Oh, here's our chip. Okay. This is, there it is. Okay.
What's the name of the color again?
Kumquat.
Yes. That's it. Never remember.
I'm sorry?
Almost matches your
It's
shirt.
A little bit.
Yeah.
It is too.
Yeah, mm-hmm. More like Chris's, actually.
Yeah, it's like Chris's. Yeah.
See, it's already, I got two votes already. Yeah. And Tom, look at your shirt.
We're all going to have to change.
Yeah, there you go.
So let the others look at that.
That's funny.
It is close, yeah. There you go.
So that one's American Four Square.
Would that be what you folks determine?
This is a little younger. This is maybe 1910. It's also, you know, what I don't know. It has a Victorian floor plan. Actually, it was an over-under duplex. It's no longer.
What is your review of this?
This is actually the twin of the house. You can just barely, there's two of them together. They're virtually identical. They're built at the same time.
Well, again, this house, the recommendation with the guidelines is for the trim to be darker. So if he wants to change the trim color, I recommend it be open for discussion.
Which designation are you putting this one under?
Well, I think it could go under either one, really.
Because if it's
folk Victorian.
It's a four-square house, I thought, with Victorian, but it's because the
when you say four-square, you mean central hallway with four rooms?
No, four-square with the hall and the stairs in one square and then three other squares.
Stairs are on the left. It's a Victorian floor plan. It's not really. So you walk in, there's a.
It's not center hall colonial. A four-square is like if you had the four squares.
Right, it's not
one,
that.
The front square is the little, like, entry hall and stair in that quadrant.
Correct.
And then room.
Yes, okay.
Is that what it?
More or less, yeah. Because
okay.
Actually, yeah, there's a short, a small room on the back. But, yeah, roughly that's what it is.
Yeah, usually they're just basing it off the main
that's
body
a,
of the house.
That's a later Victorian style, is that what that is?
Mm-hmm.
See, the problem I had with this orange or the kumquat is Sherwin-Williams has their palettes divided into different categories. And under the historic colors, there are like 156 of them. This kumquat is under their teenager line. So I really don't think it's muted enough to put on a house like this.
Teenager?
And at the very least, I'd like to see a sample painted on the house, not just to prove it from a chip.
There was some samples painted on the first house that kind of looked that color. Was that
was
color?
The color, actually. I had an earlier approval to paint, but I didn't want to, I changed my mind. I didn't want to paint that house kumquat. I wanted to paint this house kumquat, so I kind of switched it up. So kumquat has been approved, but not for this house. It's been approved for the
was it?
First house.
Okay. How long ago?
A year, maybe, year and a half.
So I assume that was administrative?
Yes.
Yeah.
But I think we have to first figure out what the group is calling this, because Queen Anne and Folk Victorian have completely different guidelines. Based on the floor plan, and I only based it off of what we had online, it looked like a four square, which says light colors, simple color schemes, one color for the body, one for trim, light colors predominantly for dwellings, and then we list body yellow, light gray, light blue, light green. So as Kay is discussing kind of lighter versions of things, and then the trim being white or off-white. So I think that's where you're coming from, is yeah. that in the guidelines, it's talking, we specifically say lighter. And I personally am not opposed to the orange realm, but I think if what Kay suggests is in that realm, there are so many colors in the, you know, we don't say you have to go to Sherwin-Williams or anyone, but they often have the historic lines that we would like to see one that would follow in this lighter guideline. And sometimes there might be some just five steps up in color range from that, or if you folks feel that seeing a sample might suffice and making you feel it's lighter, because sometimes when there's more of it, it reads differently.
It can go the other way mm-hmm. as well and be really...
But what do some others feel with our guidelines saying, you know, lighter colors? Because I just want to follow this, because that's, even though we're redoing guidelines, we are still under this.
So what does it say for the four square, lighter shades
for the base? Lighter colors predominantly for dwellings of this style.
See, I don't see this as a four square. I see this more as a Victorian. Four square wouldn't usually have the bay windows and the gable ends and all that. So I think this, I think you could really, I mean, I guess you can argue that, but I think I'd more or less follow the Victorian guidelines for this one.
So that's calling, so.
Which so. Doesn't meet that, you know, then the trim colors are the opposite anyway, so.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I think Kay's right. I think if we could see that color, and maybe if you could go to the historic line, you might find a color very similar to that.
Why can't I use this color if it's similar? I mean, I don't understand.
Well, I guess, what was your argument, Kay, that it's just...
I think on a chip, it's this much of it. On a whole house,
yeah.
It has an entirely different effect.
I mean, to me, it looked, it looks pinkish to me.
So tell you what, I'll paint the whole house. And then if you don't like it.
Well, I think if we go back to the guidelines, and if the applications committee feels it falls more into Victorian, which it has all the elements of Victorian, here we say the body's tan, red, green, or brown, trim accents are dark olive, salmon red, and dark brown. So I think doing a sample isn't going to suffice if these guidelines are saying something completely different for this variety of house.
Well, that doesn't mean we can't. I think what they're saying is that they're darker colors,
mm-hmm.
and those are samples of darker colors. I don't think that means we can't approve any other color other than that.
Yeah.
And I think once they go with another color, that's when we ask for if you could just do a sample on the house. You know, it's talking about maybe 4x4 type of sample.
Have you already bought this paint for the other house?
I have some primer, which doesn't matter. It's getting covered anyway. But the primer isn't quite the same color. They can't tint it exactly the same, so it doesn't really look, and it doesn't have the finish. So, you know, actually, with all due respect, you're operating under old guidelines. You're considering revising those guidelines. You're not sure what classification the house is. One classification has it as dark colors. The second, the slight couple of years later, has it all as light colors. Kind of tough. Makes it kind of tough.
Well, either category. If we're saying it's Victorian, then the Victorian is saying that your trim has to be darker. If we're saying it's four square, the four square is saying that the base color has to be lighter. So either way, we're deviating from that.
Well, if you really want to get technical with Victorian, you're supposed to have three colors.
That's right.
Anyway.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're trying to work within your request to just have two colors, but I'm just not...
Because we're not either way.
A few minutes ago that two colors is appropriate.
Well,
one color for the trim, one color for the house.
We don't say three colors in here.
But we will.
I mean,
well, you're right.
We have got to be consistent.
Exactly.
If someone's deviating and it falls into what we're saying in the future, then we can...
Right. You're right.
It's up to you folks whether we're going to change midstream, but until they're adopted, I think we need to be a little bit careful that we're not just muddying the waters with something. But I think where it really comes down to is that is a very vibrant color. It's very cool. It's very cool for Key West. It's very cool for a lot of areas. But I feel like if you look in any of the guideline books, and we do, Tom and Robin, do we still have books that can be used as examples? We did feel that if you, when you're going further from the range that we're saying here, that you are welcome to look through those books and make a case for what you want to do. But what we are seeing over and over again is a more muted tone of those. And I don't mean substantially so, but it's, like Kay said, it's just such a small amount, and it's a 10-year thing that's going to happen, so we try to be careful about it.
Okay. I'm not going to do a sample. How can I get a color approved without coming back to the board? Can I see the neighborhood representative and get it done that way, or do I have to come back to the board? I'm ready to paint these houses. They're in very poor condition.
We could get an advocate, couldn't we?
Well, he's Sam for his advocate already.
Oh, we did?
Yeah.
But Sam's not here today.
Not for the paint colors, but for this.
I think it would be advisable if he were to have an advocate on the paint colors to have someone who's been present for this discussion.
Right.
And not to bring in.
I'm happy to, just because I am in that neighborhood all the time, I'm happy to work with Sam on it, and that way there's not a disconnect and you feel like, well, wait, Sam's saying this, and you guys, you know, because I think that you're probably not far off from some historic examples that are, you know, in the range of what you're attempting to do. And I also think we can probably find some examples in the books that help you to come up with one that you like. I mean, we want you to find something you like and something that is acceptable within those books as well. That was one thing that's not in this guideline that we thought would be helpful, is for people to be able to have this big range of research, not to make it like a big project, but you could flip through and say, yeah, see, this is what I'm trying to do. And then we could say, well, actually, given that age of the house, that should be acceptable. And then a recommendation could be made. But I do think having two people makes sense.
All right, we have volunteer for advocate that will work with you to, if you'll paint a sample of the color on the.
I do not want to paint a sample.
I think the idea was that we, I think he wanted to get the advocate, Sam, and whoever else, being myself in this case, to try to come to a conclusion with chips versus having to do samples.
Will you make a motion?
I move that, what's the house number? 1414?
This is 1414.
1414.
Not 1412. 14.
Okay, that 1414-12 be reviewed by the advocate on the board and an additional person being myself, and that the color choices be selected using paint chips and with the best intention of finding the owner, what the owner is striving towards in a historic color.
I think that was it.
Is there a second to that?
I'll second that.
Okay. And who is the who
Sam,
will I be seeing?
Commissioner Ross Kelly and Commissioner Deanich.
Okay.
And then we'll just come up with a time that is good for you to get together as soon as possible.
And I can get your contact information from Robin?
Yes.
Okay.
All right. Any Thank other you. Comment or question on that motion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, sir.
Thank you.
You have a plan. Okay, the next item on the agenda is a request of Randolph College to construct an asphalt parking lot and brick walkways at 2711 and 2715 Rivermont Avenue. We have representatives. Would you please state your names and addresses for the record and your involvement in this project.
Hi, my name is John Leary. I'm the Assistant Director of Maintenance at Randolph College.
My name is Tommy Hammock, and I work for Wiley Wilson, helping Randolph College with the design of the plans.
All right. Yeah.
As you can see, Can I mind if I walk up here? It might be a little easier if I walk up here, kind of show
sure.
you all what we're doing.
Do we have the laser pointer you can use too? You're welcome to step forward. That's fine.
The college has acquired this right here, which, if I'm not mistaken, is 2711 and 2715. This is an apartment building adjacent to the proposed parking lot, which is here. This house, we're here, if you all may be a little familiar with this house, this was the Moyan property, which at one time was called the Columns. Well, the college now has that house as well, and another dwelling behind the parking lot, which is right here in Westmoreland. What the college is proposing to do is to put an asphalt parking lot in here with permeable pavers. And the reason we need this parking lot here is because of the apartment buildings that are being utilized currently for most are seniors at the college now. And the parking is not enough, to be honest with about that. And then, of course, this house right here, which is the Moyan house, I'll refer it to as the Moyan house, is going to be made into admissions. So admissions is going to leave the campus and go across the street. It's going to be a little bit more viable area for admissions to be away from the campus, so people can come to admissions across the street, opens up other offices that we need as well on campus. So the parking lot will be asphalt with permeable pavers. And you can see here that this portion that I'm pointing at right here would be the permeable pavers, okay? And I'm not an engineer, and I might have to ask Tommy to help me out with this just a little bit, because he is. And he's kind of helped design what we've got here now as far as the permeable pavers, the asphalt, and the planting materials that we have here as well. But in essence, down here would be a retention pond to where runoff from the parking lot would go to. Tommy, correct me if I'm wrong. I believe we already have a conditional use permit for that.
Right, to put the parking.
We already have the CUP, of course, to do the parking lot.
Right, within the residential area.
And the materials that we have chosen was asphalt. And the reason, one of the biggest reasons asphalt was chosen was, well, we got asphalt here in this area, which is to mix in with just, it just makes sense to use asphalt. And that's why the asphalt material was used for this portion here, and then permeable pavers here, along here. The planting material, there's a 30-foot
setback
from this street, which is Westmoreland. So you can see that the parking lot does not start to at least 30 feet, but it's angled as well to where when you look at the house from Rivermont Avenue, the Moyan house, which would be admissions, you won't see as much as the parking lot since the house is angled and where you look at it. Mm-hmm. Being in a residential setting, we wanted to incorporate all those factors in there, and along with the materials that we want to use as far as the pavers and the colors are concerned as well. Now, there's nothing set in stone as far as the planting material is concerned, and in fact, that's going to be refined. Tommy, okay. Do you have anything that you can add?
One other thing to note is, can I see that? Not the entire parking lot is not within the historic district. This gray area is the historic district, which follows the property line here and then here. So we've got a small portion of the parking stalls here that's in the district, and then the drive aisle portion here is within the historic district. The remaining part of the parking back here is not within the historic district.
Then I have a question for our staff then. With that detail, are we only concerned with that portion within the district, or are we looking at this as in its entirety as a project?
The HBC's role is just what is within the district, which would be the drive aisle and the brick patio area, and just that small portion of those parking spaces.
Correct.
This brick patio area here.
So you're primarily looking at this brick patio and what the drive aisle should be.
May I ask one more question? What is the house on Westmoreland that's adjacent to it? Do you know what age that house is? Is that, and what style?
I do not know. I do not know the age. I really do not know that. I don't have that information.
Okay. Do you know the house number?
227 Westmoreland.
Yeah.
Okay.
While the commissioner is looking at that, let me ask the applications committee if you've reviewed it and have comment or recommendations.
We have, and since now we're only looking at the historic portion, what the guidelines do say is that they discourage the use of asphalt. So with that said, our recommendation is to open it for discussion with the rest of the commissioners.
All right. Let me ask then for comment or question.
I had a question. I think the design itself has a lot of merit. The question I have is about that Westmoreland house. Is that on a historic register?
Not that we're aware of, no.
But that's not within the area, that's not within the historic district.
But if it's in a if it was a National Register property, I think this committee might have some comment on it.
But I think we've just been advised that the purview of the commission on this application pertains only to that small area that is within the district.
That house that you're referring to is probably a 1920s house, I would think.
1924.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I doubt, and it's a very small house.
I was going to say 1920s, but I didn't know for sure.
I'm going to ask that we confine our review to that area that is strictly within the boundaries of the historic district. And so on that, let me open it up again for question and discussion. Since our guidelines do discourage asphalt as a material in historic districts, now, I think I might comment that, generally speaking, our guidelines look at residential properties. This is a little different. Really, it's commercial property. But let me ask the other commissioners to comment, and maybe they have a recommendation.
So that whole thing is asphalt. The only reason it looks two different colors is because the darker one is the historic district.
Yeah.
Is that
mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's correct.
Yeah.
The entire area is asphalt, tying into an existing asphalt parking lot. The only reason it's darker is to distinguish the line of the historic district.
Okay.
Even though it's only a small portion, the handicapped parking near the building, I was just curious, you've got the pervious pavers around the back side, the two sides,
here,
two legs of the
here,
L.
Yes.
Yeah. Was there a reason why they weren't continued around just...
The area that is pervious pavers is put in there to satisfy stormwater regulation.
Okay, so you kept it, you know,
right.
To what was needed there. Okay. Well, I guess so the comment I would have is it seems the garden itself and the patios are a good integration into what I would expect to see for Victorian landscaping. Currently, that's a big U-shaped turnaround, so you're actually, from street perspective, everyone going by sees a certain amount of pavement there. If I'm not mistaken, where you have the curve, there's actually an alternate curve that's a drive-in currently, and you're replacing that?
Currently, there's a drive here, yes.
Right.
And
so
then another drive that goes back behind the property.
So I would say, you know, Commissioner Bonner definitely wants to follow the guidelines, which I agree on. We're supposed to comment on this side. I would say that Randolph should at least double check the age of that Westmoreland and make sure it's not something that's in a register that's protected. But that's outside of our guidelines. On the
the landscaping itself, I think that it works very well with how it's improving what's there now. You see a lot of pavement on the street currently, and now it's going to be all gardens and very residential in feel. And I also feel that even though they're switching the use of the building, as Moyan switched it from residential to commercial, it still is most definitely a residential property, so we kind of look at it from that perspective. We don't look at it from a commercial perspective. It was a house, it should be in keeping, and it looks like the gardens that are proposed are very much in keeping with that idea of a Victorian house and very, you know, very well done. But that would be my comment on the garden area and what's seen from Rivermont.
And what is the main screening going to be for the side road? I mean, I see that you have a decorative fence.
There's a decorative fence as well as a hedgerow that's planned to be installed here to screen from the road.
And do you know what the hedges will be?
The type?
Yes.
I don't right now. The landscape architect is going to get back with us on the species of all the plantings, but right now it's just designated as a hedgerow.
And so is the decorative fence strictly for decoration or is it for screening? Or do you know that?
The decorative fence that we're anticipating putting up there wouldn't be any type of screening. It's
okay. You know, because
a picket, small picket fence that doesn't screen anything. I mean, it's there to be a decorative feature and
oh, that's the existing fence.
No.
Well, there is an existing fence there that will not, that'll okay. come down, of course.
So I'm just having a little trouble seeing it. The decorative, I see the row of hedges. Is the fence behind that?
Correct.
Okay, and we don't know what that is yet.
The fencing?
Right. Other than it's decorative. We don't know the style or what it's going to look like.
Well, the style that we were going for is the style that it's used out on Ward Road. It's for the barrier to keep kids and pedestrians from going across the road. That's what they're going for, is the black decorative fence. I mean, it's not a privacy fence by no means.
So the hedges are the only thing that's going to be screening that first row of asphalt parking.
Correct.
Yes.
The hedgerow that's planned here.
Okay. And the rest of that's grass. So it's basically the parking lot, grass, a decorative fence, and the hedge.
Right.
And being the 30 foot off of Westmoreland is going to help as well, since it kind of is in a residential area. It's going to kind of help that parking lot, the feel of it, and when you look at it.
What's the elevation difference between the base of Westmoreland and the top of the parking deck? It's got to be at least a few feet if I remember that area correctly.
Kind of flat. Well, I don't know that. I mean, Tommy, if you don't know,
think it's a few feet. I think that it's fairly flat. I don't have the full set of plans that has the contours on it.
It's pretty flat. I mean, yeah. I will tell you, Westmoreland might be a foot lower than, but it's pretty flat.
I walked it yesterday. It's almost level.
And if you look at the site plan, I think that the intent of our group is that what is seen from the historic district follows the guidelines. And so if you don't have the plant materials yet, I think maybe this is something, I don't know who the advocate for that neighborhood is, but maybe this is something this group would be interested in. If I've got it right where you're headed on the hedging, part D on page 104 says the parking area should be screened with hedges. So I think your landscape architect would probably be able to find something quite suitable. And as long as we know what their top height is, you mm-hmm. know, at maturity, that would work.
Sorry to interrupt, but the hedges are defined. That parking lot screening is defined by zoning boards, minimum requirements. Basically 3 foot tall is what.
So that's the minimum, and then what this group recommends is based on this guideline, correct?
Well, but you're only recommending it for this.
I'm recommending it.
But you don't have any purview over what's outside of the historic district. You're only what's in the historic district, like Mr. Boner said earlier, is just this drive aisle.
Okay, that may be true, but if you look at the shaded area, it covers more than what you see from the historic district. And I don't think I doubt Randolph would have any problem with what the line of thinking that I've got here, because they're trying to be a good neighbor. They're doing an excellent job with their layout. Is that the historic district wraps the majority of that parking lot. You see the shaded area down below. So what you see from the historic district, I think, does bear some comment from us. Whether or not the line is right in the middle, I doubt they're going to put five hedge bushes of one height and then jump to something else. They certainly have the ability to do that, but it'd almost be silly to do that. And I think that because our guidelines specifically say you should, you know, hedge that and shield it, that we would respectfully request that they keep a consistent hedge rather than have it divide right at the line.
Where does the fence end? Start and end.
The fencing starts at the corner of the Westmoreland property. Goes along the setback in hedgerow, turns and goes over and connects to this edge, this corner of the Moyan property.
Okay, so I think we can request that the fence and hedge or final landscaping still comes to the board, can't we? Because if we do have purview over that small area of hedges, so if that's what we, you know, just saying for the same reason, I think if we approve something there, they're going to probably follow through with the same one.
Yeah, they're not going to change the fence halfway through.
Yeah, I think as Commissioner Dianich just pointed out, we do have purview over that section in the shaded area, but obviously, as she points out, you want something consistent along that line. And I think what we have, what we're looking at, and what we have before us to review is not adequate for us to make a determination right now.
May I offer one idea? And I think this is where Commissioner Morris was going when he was asking about the shielding. If that hedge shields the parking lot so that we're not seeing a lot of cars, because it never traditionally had a lot of cars in the backyard of a Victorian, but if that hedge was there, then the asphalt that you're proposing wouldn't be in view, and then I think would be less objectionable to everyone. So just by dealing with the hedgerow, you can probably solve a lot of things, because otherwise the asphalt might be considered objectionable, since in our guidelines it says don't do it. But we certainly see, I think all of us see the reasoning why you're doing it, and the pervious pavers are a very good idea. So I think, but I don't want to speak out of turn. Can some others weigh in that if that hedge shielded it so that it's doing kind of what we would expect in a historic neighborhood, that the asphalt may not be a problem, or?
Yes,
well, that's what I was getting at. I mean, okay. I was even looking at the possibility of the fence being more of a privacy fence as opposed to a decorative fence, because a privacy fence would screen that a lot better.
The zoning ordinance requires that hedge be 3 feet tall, like Tom mentioned. Are you saying that we need the hedge to be taller?
Are they saying it can only be 3 feet?
No.
Well, we're just looking for screen. So what I'm looking at is how to screen the parking lot. That's what
approximately
I'm
five would do it.
No, that was the intent of the hedgerow, is to screen the parking lot from Westmoreland.
Okay, if it so needs we're all to be, on the same page.
Yeah.
With that.
Yeah.
So
well, we don't know what material and what height that is to be.
Could we have it approved with a minimum height suggested from you guys?
Well, I think one thing we could do is approve it based on the screening with the fence and hedging coming before us. Is that, you know,
well,
being approved?
One thing I was thinking is that if the screening's in place, the fence becomes less of an issue,
mm-hmm.
because the screening's going to hide the fence anyway.
Yeah, so I guess that's another question. If the hedges are going to be higher than the fence, what's the purpose of? Oh, the fence is just to keep children out. Is that
yeah, they
is?
need to keep my kid the skateboarder out. So so I don't mind that. So if we were to approve the 5 foot, and their landscape architect is, I'm sure, fully qualified to come up with good hedge material in that category, I think I'd be okay approving it as is, but the only thing I think is I do think we need to see the fence just in case every other applicant, we require them. So it would be unfair of us to just say.
Submit a picture of the fence?
Yeah, but would you folks be okay with them sending that in even like tomorrow or something like that? And then we just, these are trustee.
I would suggest that we ask for an advocate that would review that. I think we're very close. I think we agree in principle. We agree with what our guidelines suggest should be in place. And I don't think you're, I'm not hearing any objection. It's just the details aren't there. Mm. So I would suggest that we have an advocate volunteer to look at those details.
Do you want to do that since you're by there all the time?
Yeah, I live right by there. I'm happy to stop by your facilities.
Then you have an advocate to review that. Now, is there a motion on the COA?
I will move that it be that the applicant application be approved as is with the stipulation that the designated advocate approve the decorative fence and the screening hedge.
Is there a second to that?
I'll second that.
All right. Any other comment or question? Are you clear on that, sir?
Yeah. If would you like to contact me at your earliest convenience?
That'd be fine. The only other question I have is, did they submit paver material, or is that brick pavers?
A picture.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We submitted a photo.
Okay.
Yeah. Of what that's.
Oh, yeah. It's just the brick. Oh, that was the second email you sent, Robin. That's mm-hmm. right. Yeah. I'm sorry. I didn't print that one out.
It is in Dropbox too.
Okay. Yeah, that's, I forgot
there
that went.
There, yeah, you just, the color that we picked right actually is a color that we have on campus.
Okay.
And we thought that would be perfect.
Okay.
But you said you weren't sure of the design?
Well, we probably won't do, I think what we're looking at there looks like more of a herringbone design. What we have on campus is not a herringbone design. We would probably keep it with what we have currently on campus now, which is basically like a running bond pattern. It's just what we have.
Our concern is that you would lay them so there would be grass in between, and we wouldn't approve that.
No, and that will not. No, of
that's
course.
That's not where you're going with
no.
that.
No, absolutely not. That we'll make sure that we have to kill our grass.
Yeah.
Have you ever walked on our campus?
Yes.
If you walk on our campus, it's, you won't see very much grass, believe me, in the pavers. But that's for sure. That's right.
Does that answer the question? All right.
We
have a motion and a second. Any other comment or question? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, sir. Thank you for enlightening us, and glad to help you. Next item is a request of Tom Gertie to enclose a covered porch on the bathhouse at 3120 Rivermont Avenue. Mr. Gertie?
Good afternoon. Tom Gertie. I live at 3555 Round Hill Road in Lynchburg, and my office is at 1022 Commerce Street downtown, and I'm a building contractor.
All right. And you submitted quite a few photos.
Virtually none of which you can see the.
Yeah. I yes. I was there and walked around your house, and perhaps others did too. Does the application committee have a recommendation, comment, or question?
Well, for that, yeah, we do. I mean, for that one reason that you cannot see this, the building, I believe, was built. 1970s, that particular building. And because you can't see it, we recommend that it just be opened for discussion.
All right. Any question? Or?
This is the first time seeing this sketch. That was my
objection. With the application.
No, that was in
there.
That was
in there.
It's in there?
In here, yeah.
So basically, you're enclosing that existing porch.
Yeah, right now they have an existing covered area. And we want to enclose that existing covered area with no structural changes to the roof. and then bump out that small covered area for a sitting area in front of the existing structure. Finishes, all the same finishes, and nothing is getting any closer to a property line, and nothing will increase its visibility from any other property owner or from front or rear of property.
How far is that from the from Rivermont Ave to the...
From Rivermont Ave, it's probably 200, 200 feet, I'm guessing.
Okay. I personally know Mrs. Harris, and I've been in the house several times, and you can almost not see this from the house.
It's true.
I mean, it's nestled in the back. And
One of the pictures I took was actually from their back, their pool, behind the house, and you can just make out the roof line, and that's it. It drops way below the road.
It does.
And
how much does it drop below the road, you think?
Oh, the top of the roof is probably... probably 18 feet below the main floor level of the house.
Okay. That's the top of the roof?
The top of the roof is probably 18 feet below the main floor level of the house. And the bump out, again, is coming into an area that is already a patio area where they have walks coming up to this existing structure.
This is considered an outbuilding, I would say, and it's not a permanent structure in the sense that it is occupied residential space. I guess we would consider that under our outbuilding guidelines.
Well, the other thing is the Harrises have owned this property for generations. So, I mean, they really care about it. They're not just throwing up something inappropriate.
But all, yeah, we just have to base it on... I think that it's not visible from the street.
No. Not at all.
So
no,
it's not visible from anywhere, really.
And the roof is 18 feet.
You can walk to the gate. He has a photo here somewhere of...
I took photos going down both sides.
That
you
view.
You cannot see it going down both side property lines. I took it from their pool.
I didn't go far enough.
You can just make out the roof.
Drawings before. But what they're trying to do
the,
is
the backyard,
make it a guest house more than a half house.
Grade is a considerable drop.
Significant.
And it drops
totally
further
invisible.
Beyond the pool.
Mm-hmm. Well, they had to build up just to put the pool in. So they built up, so they've got a significant drop at the pool. And then from there down, it still continues to drop down to this building. So it's down in pretty much of a hole.
All right. Do we have a recommendation or a motion?
Approved with the materials to match existing. Is that appropriate?
That's what the plan is. Yeah.
And that the committee has noted that it is not visible from a public way and is in compliance with guidelines.
Well, is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Do they need a building permit for this? Yes.
Yes, we do.
I think you've applied, haven't you?
What's that?
I think you applied for that already.
Yes,
right?
that's what triggered it because I thought it was so far off the road that it didn't come into play in the district.
All right. Any other comment or question? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, sir.
Thank you,
go forth
and gentlemen.
And build. Okay. Next item on the agenda is a request of Edward Wetherill to remove wood flooring and stone steps for the front porch and replace with brick at 312 Washington Street. Mr. Wetherill present? Anyone to represent Mr. Wetherill? We always refrain from reviewing an application if the applicant or representative is not here to respond to questions. In this case, I will defer to the commissioners if there are questions, whether they wish to table this until the next meeting, or if there are no questions and it's clear enough, we can act on it.
I think it should be tabled.
They are changing materials from wood to brick.
Yep.
So.
All right. I'm hearing a consensus that this application be tabled until the next meeting. Is there a motion to that effect?
I will move that we table this application until our next meeting.
And a second?
I'll second.
Call for a vote. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. The next item is a request of Arthur Smith to replace a pipe fence destroyed by an automobile. Replace it with wrought iron hoop and picket fence at 2811 Rivermont Avenue. Are you Mr. Smith?
I am. I'm Arthur Smith. I live at 3101 Link Road, number 108, Lynchburg. And I own 2811 Rivermont Avenue, the Warwick Apartments. They were built in 1916, and I had a woman high on cocaine drive through the front yard. And I have no preference as to what fence goes back. You tell me. That was my question when I called.
I saw that answer.
All right, so.
Just going too fast?
All right, is there a comment or recommendation from the applications committee?
Yes. We did look at it, and I believe your application states that you would replace it with the same fence that's the decorative fence in the front.
I'll replace it with whatever you want.
Well, that is acceptable with the guidelines. It is also acceptable to replace in kind. So if you wanted to put the pipe back, that's also acceptable.
It costs $2,250 to put the pipe back. If you want something prettier, now's the time to speak up, because there's the money coming from the insurance company.
Well, we're not the landscape designers. We simply use our best judgment to review proposals in accordance with the guidelines that we have. The proposal that we have is for the hoop and spear fence. I guess my sense is that's what's requested. Now you're telling us that you would also be willing to replace.
I didn't make a request. I called and said, what would you like there? And I ended up on your agenda.
Oh, well, how did we get a proposal for a hoop and spear fence?
They sent me a paper to sign to end up on this hearing.
Old pipe fence destroyed by automobile replaced with hoop and picket wrought iron fence to match front fence installed many years ago. That's what the application says.
So
I really don't care.
You guys found the hoop and spear to be
in keeping?
Yes. Well, they already have one there.
Yeah.
So if it's in kind.
Yeah. Well, what's there was not there originally.
The portion that is there is on the front along Rivermont Avenue, and there is a section on the side, I believe. No, there's no hoop and spear on the side?
There's pipe on the left side, and there was pipe on the right side.
Okay.
And there was pipe in the rear.
Okay.
But it's ugly. And if you want something that looks a little better, let's do it.
Okay.
And I will move that we approve the application as submitted to replace the damaged pipe with the same fence design and material as the existing front fence.
The hoop and spear.
Of the hoop and spear design.
Wrought iron.
Good enough.
All right. Thank you. Oh, wait a minute. We're gonna act on that. I have a motion.
I will vote.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second it.
All right. Any other comment or question? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, sir. Thank you very much. Okay. We have a request of Dr. William Hobbs, Jr. to install a handicap ramp at 910 Harrison Street.
I'm William Hobbs. I live at 1415 Northwood Circle, and I'm a volunteer with Interfaith Outreach. And we had a request from Centra Home Health for Mary Harvey, 910 Harrison Street, to assist with installing a ramp, a handicap ramp. She's dependent on a walker and a wheelchair. And I went to see her a week ago, and she said, well, we're in a historic district, so. I made some calls and came in to see Robin Craig, and she showed me some things on the about fencing and had me fill out this application, and here I am.
All right, sir. If I'm not mistaken, we did review something on this house about 3 months ago, and I believe Commissioner Morris was involved in that, were you not? You're familiar with the structure and the owner?
Mm-hmm. Well, not the owner so much.
Okay.
The daughter,
all right. So you have some familiarity with the situation?
Correct.
And so would you like to make a recommendation or?
Well, I'd like to ask a question.
Sure.
Do you know by any chance what, I guess you're planning on coming in right from the sidewalk to the front door?
Yes, right off the front steps there. Those two pipes on either side of the present steps are 54 inches apart.
Okay.
Our ramps are 42 inches apart, so it would go inside of that, and it's supported by 4x4s that are on pavers that can be removed. These ramps are built in modular form. They're not permanent, and when the need is gone, they can be disassembled and removed and used elsewhere.
Sorry, I didn't bring my iPad with me today. Is there a diagram that shows this house and its relationship to the street and where the ramp's going?
The sidewalk is made up of those bricks that you can see in that photo. And it's approximately 20 feet out to the sidewalk, which is also those patterned dark bricks.
Will those brick remain?
Well, we would have to, in order to get the handicap ramp to be flush with the pavement, we'd have to remove some and put it in ground level.
Okay.
I mean, you can't, there's no point in having a handicap ramp where you have to step up 6 or 8 inches to get onto it. So they would be saved. And we put them under the ramp, and if it, and when it's taken out, they could be put back in there.
All right. Do you have questions?
I have some pictures of the property.
Move that since this is a temporary situation that it can be removed, that we accept the application as submitted.
May I ask for a second on that motion first?
Second.
All right. Now, questions?
So our guidelines and the first goal is, you know, obviously for safety and for ease of this lady to get in and out of her house. But the other part is that many applicants who come in are given a lot of scrutiny to the application, and temporary ramps often tend to become permanent. So and we hope for her sake that she has a long life of using this ramp. So the idea that this thing would be coming down in 6 months or 2 years, I think we can't really put that in anything because that would be unfair to the occupant. But it seems as though if it's going straight off the street that we're doing exactly what we say not to do, that we say to put it on the side. And so I thought maybe this would be a case where an advocate could see if we could come up with a way to make it less obtrusive.
Do you, I actually looked at it, but do you know what the side lot line is? It doesn't look like it's much at all.
Well, that's,
what?
I don't know, there's a picture of it and you can see it drops off precipitously in the back of the house. It's, I mean.
Well, I was saying, I think what she's saying is if you could come in from the side and go into the, you know, remove the side rail and go in that way. I don't know if that would what that would solve though, because you still would have to come in through the you still have to come in through the front somehow.
Well, Tom, I think you had a picture of the front, and that looks like maybe somewhere between 6 and 8 feet on the side.
No, I don't think it's that big.
Well, I'm talking about on the right side.
Yeah, I don't think it's, you can't go by these yellow lines.
Well, they don't show up very well here, but there's a big tree to the right of the walk and the left of the walk with all these roots that are coming up in the yard. So it's very irregular, and there's a big tree there.
Who owns the driveway? Does she own the driveway?
I don't know whether there's...
It looks like a drive. There's a curb cut.
I don't believe there is a driveway there. I think that, I mean, the house next door is pretty close, and it's dilapidated. It's probably been condemned, would be my guess, but I don't know.
That house has recently been purchased at auction, and it is intended to be rehabbed.
I just think that there's the tendency to immediately want to allow this and approve it because of the concept that's temporary, but it goes completely against our guidelines. And in fairness to the neighbors, who are given great scrutiny for everything they do, as they should, as long as we're following the guidelines, that this needs to be dealt with in a better way. This is coming straight, because this could be up for 20 years. You know, if she's mid-70s, it could be up till she's 95 or 100 or 102. So I feel like that it's not acceptable as submitted. Definitely we want to try to get something that's a good solution as fast as possible, but it also has to meet our guidelines. So I think that this would be a situation, and I'm not trying to come up with extra things to do in my spare time, but but I will. I'm happy to look at it if no one else has time to look at it. Because I do think the ramp, we've dealt with some ramp situations, been able to come up with some really good ways of doing it that is much less obtrusive. And it's a absolutely lovely house. So to put something on it that will stay for a long time, that is in contrast, also sets a bad precedent, because we've heard several people come in today cite precedent, and it's going to happen again and again where they cite precedent. And if we approve this, then we're going to get the $500,000 house saying, well, you allowed it there. What's the deal? It's discrimination based on income, reverse discrimination. So I think we've got to be very careful that we follow our guidelines.
In lieu of going straight at the stairs from the sidewalk, just kind of shooting from the hip, how would you expect to get there? You're talking about trying to go in sideways?
Well, one,
but you still have to come off the sidewalk, right, to get to the house?
That's true, but there's a certain amount of labor that's going to go into any ramp that's done, and so it could be that going sideways, doing a darker color. Also, if you're not a 1 to 12 slope, if you're a 1 to 20 slope, it's no longer a ramp. It's just considered a sidewalk. That might be a solution, but I think a fair shake has to be absolutely, you know, these folks are doing their best on a volunteer basis, I assume, even. But, you know, they don't have someone in the background kind of working, trying to come up with a solution that meets these guidelines. They're just saying they do have a modular system that works, but that modular system doesn't meet any of our guidelines. So we at least need to look at it further.
Are you willing to do that?
I'm willing to do it.
Is it the guidelines of the placement or the guidelines of what the ramp looks like?
Placement and appearance of the ramp, I think, are both. It says that our diagram shows it on the side of the house, so that's, it should not be the focal point of the house. Yeah. So on page 105, there's like a preferred location that's off to the side, less obtrusive. Our main goal is that the streetscape stay like it was when it was built. So this ramp starts back on the side, and this ramp is right in the front. And so what we're doing is looking at an application where it's right at the front, even more so it's right at the front door. And I did not have a chance. I looked at all the other applicants. I did not have a chance to go by this. I would probably have maybe something more pithy to say on a solution if I'd gone by, but I just didn't before this meeting.
Well, on that last picture, it showed that there's appears to be more porch to the right of the house as you're facing the house. I don't know if over on the side adjacent to the house that's been sold at auction, over to the far right, where there's 42 inches. I mean, some other houses, we'd cut the banister and come
right.
off there. So
right.
it's not directly up the front steps. It's
right.
not over the walk. We would go over the ground and go mm-hmm. out to the sidewalk. We would have to
Yeah, I'm
sink
hopeful,
it into-
based on what Tom Martin was looking at, it looked as though there might be some room on that side to do something like that.
Didn't you say there was a tree there?
Well, there are trees in the front yard. I don't know whether there's enough to get.
Now, that's why I feel like that it's a lot of this is based on site conditions, trying to understand where the lot line is.
I mean, if it could go off the side of the porch there.
Which side, sir?
Off the right side.
Mm-hmm.
Because that looks like it's at the same level as the front steps. If you go off the other side of the porch, you can see it drops off there.
Yeah, that part gets trickier.
I mean, 904 and 906 are basically going up a steep hill there.
Yep.
But if we went off, I mean, we could possibly go off the right-hand side behind the column. So it would come out, but then it would come forward to the stream.
How much space would you need for that?
42 inches.
Yeah, just to meet the ADA guideline.
Can we look up what the side lot line setback is there? See what it is? Any way of finding
it? The side setback?
Yeah, do we know what that side setback is?
I think you mean it's between.
Between?
You mean between the, like what she's got
right.
on the side of the house to the property line?
Correct.
It can only be an estimate. Tom can.
It's about 8 feet.
Yeah.
And Tom.
Just estimate.
So
usually,
8 feet, you could do that then.
Well, but usually there's some permanent markers that would indicate like the neighbor's fence or her fence. Usually you can tell when you're out there. I mean, I could do this on my way home and, you know, get some ideas. I mean, I just think this ramps are very important. They're very important so that people can age in place. But it's especially important that we do our best to follow the guidelines because it's not fair for this house to have one thing done and then in Diamond Hill or some neighborhood that's all fixed up for them to have to do something else. I think.
Sir, were there alternative siting looked at?
What do you mean, like doing it on the side? Or
yeah,
what?
I mean, when Interfaith Outreach decided to do this, how was this? How is what you're proposing decided? Did you look at alternative placements?
No, not really.
I think what I'm hearing is that, and I respect Commissioner Dianich's thorough review on this, we are particular about ramps, and I think our guidelines are intended to make the ramp accessible and available to the occupant, certainly, but as least conspicuous as possible. Now, on some sites, you have a lot of latitude. You have other entrances or you have setbacks. Here it's obviously somewhat limited, but I don't know that we've really been able to investigate alternatives. We may find ourselves right back where we are right now, but I think it's worthy of investigating alternatives for us to do our due diligence. That's my view of it, and that's what I'm hearing from commissioners. Is there disagreement with that?
No.
I'd like to ask another question before.
Yes, sir.
The ramp that we have in the picture that we submitted does have exposed balusters on the side. And I think from the stuff that was shown to me that was in the computer by Ms. Craig last week, I thought that would probably be the major concern. So I went to our warehouse and did some modifications to enclose the baluster so that it looks better. And I have, didn't have a chance to submit those so they could be up here like that, but you can see what it does when we put, that's 2.5 ramp, that's 25 feet of ramp right there. But we can enclose the banister easily. This is a picture of one of our ones. And so see what we did is I just enclosed it here.
I think that's a big improvement.
And it's enclosed on the bottom too. Mm-hmm. And then it could either have a 2x4 at the top or a thinner board that would go across the top also, which would be more.
Do you mind if we pass this down?
No, that's fine. It's between the two, between the green ones there.
And if you go back a few, you'll see the more 1970s version.
I don't know where the historic district starts, whether it just starts at 8th Street going up that hill. Mm-hmm. But there's a porch at 712 that I took a picture of that's also in there that has exposed balusters.
I think it is, but that kind of brings to the point that people do look at.
Starts at 9th.
The district starts at 9th. 9th Street.
No, it starts at 12th. It goes all the way to 12th.
Oh, the other direction, yeah, it goes to 12th.
Oh, yeah. 9th.
Well, it's partway up from 8th and partway up toward 9th, because it has a little sign there on the side.
That's right. Yeah, it's between 8th and 9th.
Started or not.
It's between 8th and 9th. All right, we have a motion and a second to approve, but there's been a considerable discussion, and I think concern enough that we might want to modify that.
I will modify my motion to have an advocate review the site for an alternate location and to modify the rail to the pictures that were being showed to the commissioners at this meeting by the applicant.
Will the seconder accept that amendment? All right. Now, is everybody clear? I'm not sure I am.
Will he have to come back?
Well, that's why I'm not clear.
Okay. I always feel like even if I'm the advocate, I would like another person on this commission to review what I suggest. I just think I don't think any one of us, no one wants to put themselves out there and possibly be acting too independently. So if I could email someone, you know, a photo and ideas after we speak.
I don't mind meeting you out there. We can just meet together. And I think can we both approve as advocates?
You're really starting to have meetings outside.
Oh, that's right. So we can't.
Oh, that's how the advocate thing works.
Well,
okay.
But we did it before out there, two of us.
Yeah.
Was that not supposed to be done?
Whoops.
Really, either assign it to the advocate and let them deal with it, or bring it back.
Okay, I didn't understand that was how that worked. As long as you don't mind, I don't mind my, and it may be if I can't find a solution that really meets the letter of the law here, I would have to ask him to come back for another review. Right. But if I do find something that I feel like really does the best possible, but still gets a ramp on because she's got to have the ramp, then I would, you know, give that recommendation. And
right.
Tom and Robin, I just follow through with you folks, or how does that work?
Just submit whatever you decide to me.
Okay. Is that clear now? Is that acceptable? All right. We want to work with you. We're not trying to delay you unduly. Be bureaucratic about it, I guess. That's not the best way to phrase it, but or be difficult, let me say. We don't want to be difficult. We want to work with you and with the homeowner and meet her needs, but we just do have concerns. And I think those concerns can be resolved by your advocate, Commissioner Dianich. All right, we have a motion amended and a second. Any other question, comment? Hearing none, call for a vote. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, sir.
Great, thank you.
After you meet with her and everything, I'm not sure if you do or do not need a building permit for that. So you'll need to check with inspections and see if you need a permit for the ramp. Do you want me to give you somebody's number to call?
Oh, that would be great.
Okay, her name's Sharon, and it's 455-3898. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
All right. Is there any other business to come before the commission?
My only question is, Robin, can I email you my findings to get to Dr. Holmes, or what's a, or can you give me your phone number to coordinate?
Sure.
They've been asking questions about me.
Email's probably easiest.
All right. Any other business?
WAH2020.
Any other business?
We're just discussing. So you do have an appeal to a previous decision.
And which one was that?
The solar panels.
Okay.
So how would you like that represented? Is a member of the commission going to come and represent that, or do you want staff to represent it?
Well, let me open it to discussion. I'll tell you my... We had a lot of discussion with the applicant on when is it being reviewed by
next Tuesday.
I'm sorry?
The 28th.
28th, okay. We had a lot of discussion at the commission here before we made that determination. We tried to work with the applicant, and I think that discussion is important to convey to the city council. And so my opinion would be that someone who was present at that review should represent the commission. And I think that's, in fairness to the staff, I think that's the best way. That's my opinion. I'm open to
dissent. Can we have more, dissent? Did one person go to that meeting, or has it become a meeting?
Well, that will be a public meeting.
Okay.
And you know, I would also ask, I know that that he is resigning today, but could he go to that meeting since he was part of the commission?
No, I'm not resigning today.
His term
isn't up to the... My term doesn't expire until June 30th.
So he's actually still the chairperson.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's right. So he cannot...
I'm sorry?
He cannot represent...
No, he's still the chair until June.
Oh, okay. I can, but I don't have to. If you would like to, you're certainly welcome to. You led the discussion, it seems to me.
I did. That's fine.
Would you like to?
Sure.
All right. Good. I appreciate that.
Just put it in the Dropbox.
Okay. I'll put the information in the Dropbox that went to council.
Okay. And also, all right.
Now, do we know if the appellant has submitted anything to council or will?
He'll probably bring something to the meeting, but I don't think he's required to send that in ahead of time.
Okay.
He can
when is the meeting?
It's 7:30 on the 28th.
As I recall, this was a case where the guidelines were quite specific on the reason for the denial. Mm-hmm. And that was because the guidelines say panels must not be visible. So I'm not sure that this is not, seems to me, a question of an opinion.
Does anybody remember what the side streets are? The house faces Washington.
No. Washington is the side street. And there's a vacant lot, I believe, or at least a large lawn.
It's Harrison Street, isn't it?
It was Harrison is the address of the house.
Yeah, fronts Harrison.
And Washington.
Yes. Is the side street.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But where they wanted to put the solar panels was
right
facing Harrison.
On the roof of the garage.
And they're visible from both streets, and they're even visible, I believe, from Grace Street. But
you see the profile from Washington.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, thank you, Commissioner Morris. We'll represent the commission in this appeal. Is there any other business to come before the meeting?
In other appeals that we've had, it's very nice to have some support so that he's not there all by himself. If anybody has the time to.
Okay, Kay.
Okay.
Not me.
Yeah, I'll be there. I'm just so glad it's not me.
I may like to see this one. Okay.
All right.
Well, I guess.
Lonely at the top.
This is my farewell, my last meeting. It's been 8 and a half fun-filled years. It really has been an honor, and it's been most rewarding to me to participate for these 8 and a half years, and I don't know, something like 3 or 4 years as chairman. I've seen some staff turnover, not a lot. It's been very good, and I appreciate so much the support of our staff, current staff and the past staff as well.
This is a small token of our appreciation and esteem.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome. Isn't it beautiful?
I want to explain that I tried to find a historic photo from Federal Hill, but one of them was going to be your house, and I thought, does he really want a picture of his own house? Because you might already have a picture of your own house.
That's so then I settled on something from downtown.
That's
a parade.
All right.
That's
like
very
it.
Fun. Lots of
Nancy Marion said that's the what is now the Bank of the James building for reference.
Oh.
Right here?
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay.
It's a different, obviously not that building anymore.
I suspect somewhere around World War I this was taken.
That's really neat.
Perhaps before, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Well, thank you so very much, everybody.
Loved working with you.
Can you see that in your living room?
Yeah, it will. All my family. Thank you. All right. No other business. I'll declare the meeting adjourned.